How do you read?
That's Andy. Here we are.
Good morning. Welcome to Veterans for Peace. Trust you're having a nice day. My name is David Ross. I'm a graduate of South Burlington High School in UVM. I volunteered twice after enlisting in the Army for combat duty in Vietnam. I served as a combat medic, two tours with the 1st Infantry Division. You can't imagine, but what I did learn from this, war is not the answer. David?
You bet. Dave Ransom, Korea 54 to 56. And our guest today, Andy.
Good morning. Peace be with you all. I'm Andrew Schoerke. October the 12th, 1956. I raised my right hand and I swore to protect, preserve, and defend the Constitution of the United States. With that, I went on active duty. After attending intelligence school, I reported to Navy Heavy Attack Squadron 1 on board the aircraft carrier USS Forrestal. For the next 3 years, I served on active duty with that squadron. I flew 200 hours as a bombardier navigator on a Douglas A3D twin jet carrier-based bomber. Our mission, in the case of war, was to fly into the Soviet Union, drop atomic bombs, and return and land on the carrier. I can tell you that not one person in our squadron ever thought that the carrier would be there if there was going to be a war when we came back. I'd like to talk today about the Constitution, that Constitution which is the foundation of our American Republic. It was fashioned during the summer in Philadelphia in 1787. Over 3 months, the different voices of the different colonies managed to hammer out a document which was actually written and drafted by James Madison. And the Constitution is separated the powers of a central government, which was a big issue during the formation of the Constitution, that there would be a strong central government. They wrote the Constitution so that the three separate parts of the government, the executive branch, the legislative branch, and the judicial branch, would be separated by checks and balances such that no single department would have paramount power over any of the other two. It worked for a while and was finally ratified in 1787. The ratification was a difficult process because of the different agendas by these several different colonies which were formed into states at that time. Almost from the beginning, there were issues regarding national security. And from that time on to this very day, the issue of national security has been the paramount issue which created the differences of opinion and the subjection of the different powers of this country. The first test came during 1797 when there was a cry for war from one part of the Congress against the voice of the president. The voices in the Congress got so strong that there was a quasi-war with France. The president in 1796, John Adams, refused to go to war. He refused to go to war because under the powers of the Constitution, only the Congress has a right to declare war, and James Madison did not go along with that right of Congress. There were voices that called out against the government. In response, the Congress passed things called the Sedition Acts, which made it illegal to say anything against the government of the United States. One of those strong voices was the representative from the new state of Vermont, a man named James Lyon, who, because he spoke out, he was arrested, he was tried and convicted of violating the Sedition Act. He continued to speak out even while he was in prison. And from that, he became known as the Lion of Vermont. His name was spelled L-Y-O-N. He was called the Lion of Vermont. The issue of national security probably came to a head during that time when there was a movement in the North, voices crying out to abolish slavery. Dissenting voices in the South cried out, insisting that the states had a right to pass laws which allowed slavery, which allowed the bondage of one person to hold another in slavery. The Civil War settled that issue with 715,000 Americans being killed in that conflict. Over the years, different issues came up, which raised issues with the Constitution. Typically, it was the powers of war. Who can declare war? In our recent history, those powers were tested and challenged and did not hold forth. In 1964, the President of the United States, Lyndon Johnson, allowed us how that the reported attacks on U.S. naval forces in the Gulf of Tonkin by forces of the Republic of North Vietnam constituted an attack on the United States, and he accordingly began conducting, under his orders, airstrikes against the Republic of North Vietnam. This was a clear violation of the War Powers Act. He had no authority to declare war. It was called something else besides war, and that became the way that all these wars since have been carried out. In response to this usurpation of congressional and the constitutional authority to declare war, the Congress passed a thing called the War Powers Act in 1973. The War Powers Act required certain things to happen. The President, if he authorizes the use of military force, he has to report to the Congress that he did so, and it is up to the Congress within 60 days to verify and acknowledge and pass a law allowing that armed conflict to occur. That didn't make a hill of beans, because since then, many presidents have decided to utilize the armed forces of the United States to conduct military action against presumed powers which threaten, again, the national security of the United States. President Reagan ordered the United States military to attack whoever was the power in charge in the island of Grenada, for heaven's sakes, a little island in the Caribbean, under the threat of a national security because this island presumably was under the control of a communist government. It was not under the control of a communist government. Again, in 1992, President Clinton decided to authorize military strikes against Serbia, which was attacking different elements in the country, the former Yugoslavia, to attack the Muslims there. And President Clinton ordered airstrikes upon the forces of Serbia. Again, a violation of the Constitution. Most recently, in our immediate history, in 2003, the President of the United States, George W. Bush, ordered attacks on the country of Iraq. This was again a usurpation of the powers of the President to do so. He had sent his Secretary of State to the United Nations to try to get them to pass an authorization to Iraq to attack Iraq. The United Nations refused to do so. The Bush administration, on the false evidence that Iraq was preparing nuclear weapons to attack the West, was false. The evidence that was presented was fabricated. The United Nations had had inspectors in Iraq since 1992 to inspect and make sure that there was no atomic research or weapons fabrication going on in Iraq. That didn't make a bit of difference. Even though the United Nations did not authorize the United States to attack, there was the shock and awe of March 20th, 2003. That is a state that continues to this day. The United States, under that authorization to use military force passed in 2003, has conducted ongoing military operations in the Middle East. Most recently, with the rise of a Muslim extremist radical group called ISIS, the Islamic State in Iraq and Syria, the United States has been conducting military operations. We have been providing, quote, advisors, quote, support personnel, quote, intelligence personnel, and armed advisors who are instructing, teaching, and we are aiding the Iraq Army. We are teaching, instructing, and aiding the Iraq security forces, two separate groups, against ISIS. An American captain stationed in ISIS sued the United States government for conducting the war without authorization from Congress. President Obama, in February of 2015, had requested Congress to pass an authorization allowing him to conduct these military operations. The United States Congress was basically in a lockdown against anything that President Obama did, and they refused to pass that kind of legislation. Nonetheless, President Obama went ahead and ordered the conducting of military operations against the Islamic State. The American captain's suit against the government to prevent it from conducting these strikes was not met in court because the court allowed that the plaintiff, the American captain, had no standing to bring his suit against the federal government. His suit was thrown out. So much for the Constitution of the United States. The resolution of all these things, I submit to you, is the right of dissent. Dissent was the foundation of the American Republic. It started soon after the conclusion of what was called the French and Indian Wars. It was a war that Britain conducted against France and a couple of other European powers. Typically, the European wars went on and on. It happened in the United States because there were French forces in North America. The dissent came because the British didn't have the money to conduct the war. Their answer was to tax the American colonies. Problem was, the American colonies had no representation in the English Parliament to speak out or even vote against the taxes. This was what became known as taxation without representation. It led directly to the insurgency, which we call the American War for Independence. This dissent continued even just before the war. Even though those initial taxes had been repealed by the English Parliament, they passed other taxes called one was called the Tea Tax and the other was called the Stamp Act. But again, these were simply charges that were levied on the American colonies to try to get money for the English to pay for their wars. We all know what happened. The colonies dissented, they became organized, the resistance became armed, and on April 19th in 1775, the dissent reached the stage of armed resistance when the militia, the American colonists, met English troops who were on their way to Concord to seize the revolutionary, the colonists' arms in Concord. The militia opened fire and the war for the American independence began. That led to the formation of the Constitution. I would like to call your attention to Article 6 of the Constitution. Article 6, part of the original Constitution, states, "This Constitution and the laws of the United States, which shall be made in pursuance thereof, and all treaties made or which shall be made under the authority of the United States, shall be the supreme law of the land." I think that is about succinct as we can get about what constitutes the law of the land. Dissent against some laws have proven to be unjust laws. Laws that were passed by states authorizing slavery. A law that authorized anybody who was able to catch a slave escaping slavery was authorized by law to return him to his owner. It was called the Dred Scott decision. Other treaty violations continued with the Native American tribes. We're seeing that played out today at a place called Standing Rock Sioux Reservation in North Dakota. At that dissent, the Indian nations, 200 being represented there, being enabled by thousands more of people who are called water protectors because of a thing called the Dakota Access Pipeline. That pipeline is taking the oil from the fracked oil found in the Bakken shale deposits of northern Dakota, and it is being intended to be piped down the Missouri River to a terminal in the state of Illinois. The reason they are building this pipeline is because the former pipelines that used to carry the oil refused to do so because there have been horrendous oil spills. One in North Dakota in 2013 spilled 843 gallons of oil. Another one in 2015 in Minnesota spilled 810,000 gallons of oil. Those pipeline companies no longer will carry that oil because they refuse to do so because the oil is a very, very corrosive product. The oil that's coming from the fractured shale has a high content of hydrogen sulfide. It is highly corrosive, it is poisonous, and the original oil companies refuse to carry it. That's why they are building this new pipeline, the Dakota Access Pipeline. That pipeline passes what is now the northern edge, the very northern edge of the Sioux Indian Reservation. The reservation did not used to be where it is today. The original treaty signed in 1855 at Fort Laramie, Wyoming, had a different boundary than where that reservation is today. The reason being that the United States government realigned the boundaries without the consent of the Indian tribes that are living there. The boundary that now exists is about 50 miles south of where the original treaty showed it. For that reason, that land belonged to the Sioux. It belonged to the Lakota branch of the Sioux. Those Sioux regard that land as being sacred land. It's sacred land to that tribe right along the west bank of the Missouri River. Under the original treaty, the Sioux were granted a reservation as far west as what were called the Black Hills. They again were sacred ground. But in the late 1860s, more and more explorers, immigrations from the east, sought to go into the Black Hills and try to find gold. That was the straw that caused the United States to embark in a war to evict the Sioux from the Black Hills. They did so with a force of arms. Later, in the 1980s, under a suit brought by the Sioux, the United States Supreme Court ruled in favor of the Sioux that they were entitled to those lands which had been taken from them illegally. It was taken from them even though there was a treaty, the law of the land, that said it was the Sioux. The settlement offered the Sioux $140 million as compensation for the land that was lost to them. And you know what the Sioux did? They refused the money. It was their land. They wanted the money back. They refused to take the money as a settlement. It was their right to the land. Those are some of the treaties that have been abrogated, the supreme law of the land, by the United States government. And the answer to resisting all of that is dissent. There was dissent rising during the middle 19th century by some women who met at Seneca Falls, New York in 1848, who began a campaign for women's suffrage, for women to have the right to vote. The right was not denied them under the Constitution, but the Constitution allows a provision to be amended.
I'd like to inject just two real quick points. One, just so viewers are aware, reservation isn't like a nice place that we were kind enough to give to them. Reservations are nations. They are sovereign nations. Our doing anything with these reservations is the same as if we decided to go annex a province of Canada. No, I'm sorry, these are sovereign nations. The other thing is, when the Constitution was sent out to the colonies for ratification, every single one of them refused. Why? They said this contains no individual personal freedoms or guarantees. Mm-hmm. You need to add this. That is where the Bill of Rights, the first 10 amendments to the Constitution, come from. Right now, what we're seeing with Trump and the Muslims is a violation of freedom of religion. The state shall make no law governing anything having to do. Religion is your own personal business. It's not part of government anything, business anything. You have a right to religion. Freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, that's demonstrations. Redress of grievances, the right to petition for redress of grievances. We do petitions. These Bill of Rights are sacred, inviolable. They are not in any way controllable by the government. They are considered by the founders natural rights, and some of this comes out of the French Revolution. Rights of man, rights that are above all all other issues, which is why the alien and sedition laws were ultimately found to be illegal, because they breached that. I apologize for injecting that.
Yeah. Well, I you're absolutely right, Dave. And something I'd like to point out, that some of the treaty violations include a thing that's called the United Nations Charter, which the United States and many, many countries in this world embarked to form following World War II. The United Nations Charter has, amongst its other paragraphs, the prohibition of war. It was formed to prevent and eliminate the scourge of war. That's what the United Nations Charter was about. Amongst other articles, it prevents a nation from attacking another unless they are threatened with, quote, imminent attack. That is the loophole that some of our governments has used to go to war. They use that loophole claiming that we are threatened, like threatened by Iraq, which did not have any weapons of mass destruction. But nonetheless, the Bush W administration was able to convince this country and stir up the war, public opinion, and start a war against Iraq. Other treaties include the humanitarian rights that are allowed to all people. Again, this was a treaty that the United States entered into. Amongst other things, that treaty forbids the mistreatment of prisoners captured in war. It mistreats the torture of prisoners. These are things which the United States has violated. They have violated them up one side and down the other against the Iraqi people following the invasion of Iraq in 2003. Many people who are active with the Veterans for Peace have participated in dissent against those kinds of actions by our government. Many Veterans for Peace have been arrested, many have been convicted, many have been jailed because of their dissent against those kinds of violations against the Constitution of the United States. Under the United Nations Charter, it prevents the attack on another country without any kind of warning. I would call your attention to the operation of what are called unmanned aerial vehicles, drones for short. For years, the United States had been running these drones into Pakistan, into Somalia, into Yemen, and by remote control, being controlled from bases, being operated from bases in the United States, these drones were launching aerial missiles against, quote, targeted terrorists in those countries. That is a violation of the United Nations Charter. There is no hostilities that were existing and ongoing in between the United States and Pakistan, between the United States and Yemen, between the United States and Somalia. It was a clear violation of the United Nations Treaty to attack those people. The Vermont chapter of Veterans for Peace began a campaign to get petition to place before our elected representatives to stop the targeted killing by these drones. And in 1993, there were Veterans for Peace who demonstrated at the drone base where they were operated out of the Hancock Air Force Base just outside of Syracuse, New York. For that, a number of Veterans for Peace were arrested and jailed. Some of them went and did time because of that.
And you were one of them that was arrested.
It was my honor and privilege to defend the Constitution in that way. We organized a petition. We circulated around the different peace groups within the state of Vermont. The result, the final product, was this petition to stop the killing, stop the drone killing. This was submitted to our elected representatives. In this position, we gained over 997,000 individual petitions, gained from 92 towns in the state of Vermont. The petitions were not able to stop the drone killing. The voices and the powers of government were too strong. Again, They stirred up the rancor of national security to justify these illegal killing of foreign nationals. Often the argument is, they're terrorists. They're terrorists. We're allowed to kill terrorists. Independent groups have gone into Pakistan, for example, and they have collected data on that. Their report indicates that of the 2,324 people that are killed in Pakistan, nearly 1,342 were civilians. Those were not even considered to be terrorists. The reason being is that the drone strikes would track an individual. They would track them typically by their cell phone signal. And if that cell phone was in the pocket of a person who was in his home with his family, the drone would launch a hellfire missile on that home, and the explosion would kill everybody in it.
And sometimes the drone would pick up through its video connection a large gathering of people, and the assumption was that many people, it's got to be the enemy getting together to do something untoward. And so they would attack a wedding party and kill 150 people that just went to a wedding. Yeah. Even worse, they have targeted funerals where everybody from all around comes for a funeral, and we just blow the hell out of it. Now you have lots more funerals. Oh, goodwill towards America? I don't think so.
No way.
Yeah, of course, it all goes back to the 9/11 attack on the World Trade Centers, conducted by an organization, a group of men called Al-Qaeda. This group was headed by an individual named Osama bin Laden. He was able to recruit many other people to follow what his attack on the United States was. In 1998, he put out what was called in Arabic a fatwa. It is a religious order to conduct a deadly strike on an enemy of Islam. Osama bin Laden in that letter stated the reason he decided to attack the United States was for three reasons. Number one, following the first Gulf War in 2001, which was organized under United Nations auspices to kick the dictator Saddam Hussein out of Kuwait, a neighboring country. Following that war, Saddam was sanctioned by the United Nations. The sanctions were enforced by the United States and some of the other countries. Amongst other things, those sanctions prevented materials and equipment being brought into Iraq to purify water, okay, to restore the sanitary structure of the city, and to limit the building of electrical, the rebuilding of the electrical system that was largely destroyed in the attack. The second reason was because the United States had supported the State of Israel, against Israel's expansion of their settlements in the West Bank area. The third reason was because during that first Gulf War, the United States had stationed military forces in the sacred land of Islam, Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia is the keeper of the sacred sites in Mecca and Medina. Those were the three reasons that Osama bin Laden led his forces to attack the World Trade Center. By the sanctions that were imposed, the World Health Organization submitted a report to the United Nations in 2002 stating that those sanctions were responsible for the deaths of an estimated over 500,000 Iraqi children.
And I'm going to add a point here. Madeleine Albright, who was the United States of America's representative to the United Nations, was asked, do you think the sanctions resulting in these children's deaths was worth it? Madeleine Albright replied, yes, we think it was worth it. What's that tell you about our country?
Veterans for Peace actively supports, advocates, and engages in actions for peace and justice. That's what we do. That is our mission. We continue to be active. Even today, there are veterans, many of whom are members of Veterans for Peace, who are going to the Sioux Reservation in North Dakota. They are acting as human shields between the authorities, the state police, the local police, private security forces who are intent on removing the protectors of the water, protectors of the Sioux sacred land. Their forces are preventing them from remaining where they are. And just recently, within the last week, President Trump has ordered the Army Corps of Engineers to provide the permit which will allow this private company to continue drilling and laying the pipeline across the Missouri River and the sacred ground of the Sioux. Most recently, on January 17th and 18th, those security forces began to push the protectors of the water off of part of the land that was outside their reservation boundary. They use tear gas. They use mustard gas. They use batons. They use what are called flashbangs. They're grenades which explode. They are using all those means of force to drive the water protectors off the land, and veterans are standing between those authoritarian forces and the water protectors. It is going to get worse. It's going to get worse. The Army Corps of Engineers has told the water protectors they have to be off of their campgrounds by the end of February. The reason being, they are going to probably begin their drilling operations as soon as the weather permits. But before they can start that, they have to drive the water protectors off the land using whatever force is necessary. My fear is that there will be casualties, but Army vets, other vets, are going to stand between the forces of authority and the water protectors. They are going to stand there as human shields. I have seen the flags of Veterans for Peace among those protectors. That's what the Veterans for Peace does. That's what we're about.
Rubber bullets are something else that are used. They are not sublethal, as we know from the use of them in Israel. They're basically bullets with a rubber coating. Yeah. They can kill. They can easily blind.
Yeah.
Water cannons,
you see,
20 below degree
yeah, water
days.
Cannons, when it's like below zero, people can die of hypothermia from that before they can get them to some place where they can get a change of clothes dried off and warmed up. One woman has lost her arm from a flashbang grenade. No, they are not sublethal. I mean, the things they are using, it's unimaginable. And I watch the news a lot. And I always see violence at Standing Rock. Police and protesters clashed. You know what? I know these people. I know a lot of the people out there. They're personal friends of mine. I will be going out mm-hmm. there probably at the end of this month. Mm-hmm. The point of it is, these water protectors, their allies like Vets for Peace, have not initiated any violence. When violence has been perpetrated against them, they have passively resisted and taken the violence. None of this violence is from the protesters. All of this violence is from the state and its various apparatuses. And it makes me really ashamed to be an American. You want to go back a little bit earlier in this conversation and his farewell address to the nation. George Washington stated, above all other things, beware of foreign entanglements. He knew the history of Europe going way back, as did Jefferson Adams, Madison, and many others. And they saw how one situation leads to war between two countries, and then all their allies come in, and the next thing you know, you got six or eight countries slaughtering each other. We have oceans on both sides of us, Canada to the north and the Arctic above that, and you have Central and South America below that. The United States is well defended just by virtue of its geography. No country has the ability to take over the United States. You might even be able to send nukes, but in the end, the victory of any war is defined by the ability of the attacking nation's troops to come in and occupy and control the land. Nobody can get an army over here. I don't care how big and how strong your boats are. You send a fleet, we'll send one hydrogen bomb. Goodbye to your entire invading army. Another thing is, America, and I won't get in whether it's good, bad, or indifferent, it's a fact of reality, America's awash with firearms. There are more firearms than citizens in the United States, privately owned firearms. And if suddenly the woods are full of people from some other country in Vermont and everyone else, it's like, hey guys, let's go hunting. I mean, yeah. I have this vision of a great tidal wave in Bangladesh, typhoon in the Philippines, volcanic eruption elsewhere. And to take advantage of the situation, here comes the entire armed forces of the United States. The Marines are coming in and cleaning up the beaches, and the Army and the Navy. They're repairing the phone lines. They're fixing the roads. We've got medicine. We have fresh water. We have food. It's an invasion of help. A couple invasions like that to save people with our vast knowledge and resources would utterly change world opinion. Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah. It's true. The rest of the world admires and respects the United States for what it has and what it's accomplished, but also the world fears America. And now, especially with President Trump, they really fear America because we do have the strongest military, and we've shown throughout history that we have no hesitation to use it. And just as Bush lied about weapons of mass destruction, going back to what was brought up earlier, the Gulf of Tonkin incident, where North Vietnam supposedly attacked the Maddox and the Turner Joy ships. And it's come out that both captains said, no, we were not attacked. It's can't say that on TV. It's not true. Time after time after time, presidents have lied. Grenada, we had to go save the American citizens that were at a little medical school. And the government of Grenada and the rebels both said, your students are on campus, they're not under threat. Any of them that are maybe in town and want to go back, we'll escort them back. Basically, both sides said, leave them out of it. They're safe on campus. Campus isn't involved. Didn't matter. We invaded Grenada. Panama. We blew the living hell out of Panama because our former ally, Noriega, he got out of favor with us, so we had to overthrow the government. It was a corrupt government. So what? They say that Iran, our next targets, could corrupt government. Yeah. Well, that's the problem of those people. Let them have their own revolution, because through the formation of a revolution from initiation to conclusion, good leadership will rise, not someone that we pick. Who was Maliki in Iraq? Nobody knew who he was. Most of the Iraqis didn't know, but some people in the State Department have heard of him, so they made him the head of the country. John F. Kennedy asked, who should we get to be the head of the South Vietnam government, which never existed? There never were two countries. So he asked Cardinal Spellman, a good Catholic, and Spellman said Diem, which was the beginning of a disaster crisis. Yeah. Time after time, we have such brilliant people in the State Department and elsewhere. They know what's going on. nobody listens to them. Male testosterone arrogance seems to determine foreign policy along with business interests. Yeah. So you really need to take a look at history, because it's not what you see in your newspapers and on your evening news. What you see there is corporate media representing corporate America. Go find alternative media. Truth Out, Truth Dig. There are lots of alternatives to get news. And question that news too. But a lot of it, if you find the right stuff, is much better.
Yeah. Dave, I think it's most important for listeners and viewers to read your Constitution of the United States. Read Amendment 1. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion, or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech or the press, or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of your grievances. Those rights are sacred. They are embedded in the Constitution of the United States.
And the three
also, be sure to read Amendment 4, the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated. If you have the National Security Agency monitoring your phone calls, your emails, your browsing on the internet, which they do constantly, they are collecting that information. Some voices say, well, that's not surveillance. That's not an intrusion of their property. I have to admit that there was no such thing as the internet in 1789. But the intent is clear. You have to be secure in your papers, your effects against unreasonable searches and seizures. There is a huge, huge warehouse out in the middle of the Nevada desert that houses all the information, all the data that is being being collected and compiled by the National Security Agency. National voices up one side and down the other say, well, it's only data. That's all it is. Does anybody believe they're not carrying the content of all that information? I sure as hell don't. I think they're keeping it stashed someplace. They can pull it up with some kind of an algorithm the minute they want to. You're afraid to email somebody who isn't Muslim overseas for fear that will be tracked and you'll be put on a watch list. A watch list that will deny your ability to be even subject to authentic laws. There are lots of laws that gets passed. In Nazi Germany in 1930s, it was against the law for a Jew to have a business. It was against the law for Jews to do all kinds of things. And we know what happened from Nazi Germany in the 1930s. Laws can be passed by whoever wants to. For example, the right of free speech. If you want to protest an inauguration of a president you did not vote for and do not agree with, if you want to protest that inauguration, you can do that, but you can only do that in a little piece of grand land in Washington that was declared a free speech zone.
So from time to time, the entire country becomes a tiny little patch that they define, and their freedom lives, their dissent lives, their opinion lives, where no one will know it.
Other instances, for example, the action that I engaged in outside of the drone base at Hancock, New York. The base of it turns out that the legal boundary of the base is at the center line of the highway, okay, that goes in front of the base. One of our demonstrators, not knowing this, was in violation of an order barring that person to come in any kind of proximity to the base. That person got arrested, right, for violating that prohibition that was imposed on her for an earlier action that she engaged in against the drone warfare. She appealed that conviction, and we're still waiting for the New York State Supreme Court to rule on whether or not she can be convicted for violating that order to be near that base.
You see, we have a real problem here. The three of us and the rest of our Veterans for Peace group, another group that I'm in and have been in for all getting close to 50 years now, Vietnam Veterans Against the War, Iraq Veterans Against the War, other veterans groups, we took an oath to defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. Nobody ever pardoned us, took away our obligations for that oath. So as far as I'm concerned, I'm still under an oath to defend the Constitution. I'm not so concerned about foreign enemies, because most of the ones are ones that we make up and then lie our way into fighting. Oh, that's where your sons and daughters are being killed for nothing. Nothing. Mm-hmm. And the enemies I'm concerned about are domestic, because they are the subversives, they are the radicals, they are the usurpers of the democratic tradition of the United States of America. They are the ones that are destroying your country. For what? Mm-hmm. For greed, for power, for arrogance. You know, even on a global basis, there is enough for everyone if we would just share. And another thought about this oil and some of this other stuff, yes, we are murdering the planet. We're killing the very planet that gives us life.
To defend, preserve, and protect the Constitution of the United States, because without the Constitution, there is no law. Without law, there can be no justice. Without justice, there can be no peace. Support, preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States.
So we'll see who we end up with on the Supreme Court. And one of the things that bothers me a lot, I mean, after 2 years in the jungles of Vietnam, and I come home, and I'm a normal student for 1 year, everything's fine, I just don't watch the news. I still have friends over there I don't want to know. And then I have nightmares, I can't escape it, I end up becoming a peace activist, not where I wanted my life to go, I kind of drafted myself. I've been doing this stuff for almost 50 years. As a little kid, I fought against racism as a 10-year-old. I'm not going to tell that story because we don't have time. Then I was an anti-war activist. Then I was pro-women's rights. Then I was environmentalist and gay rights. What's wrong? Everything's wrong. And yet, you're only looking at most. Man, I don't think it's just 1%ers. I think it's 2 or 3 or 4 percenters, but you're looking at a tiny little proportion of people that are declaring and legally illegal by twisting reality. They are calling the shots. They are controlling the evolution of this society. And you know what? I've had it. I'm 71. I probably don't have enough years left to matter, but I'm not going to put up with it. I've had the thought, you know, I should just walk away from this and just let Americans get what they deserve because Trump's going to screw them so bad, but no. Sorry. It keeps coming back to that Constitution, to that oath. And just as an 18, 19-year-old kid was willing to give his life, give my very life for my country, I still am. And a lot of people I know are. And I will leave you with my last comment on this show, something John F. Kennedy said. And you got to remember also, I'm one of three people that founded the first fully accredited nonviolent studies program at a university anywhere in the world, and it still exists, and they still use two of my courses. But Kennedy said, those who make a nonviolent revolution impossible make a violent revolution inevitable. And the Chinese have a proverb, may you live in interesting times. I think we're there.
That reminds me of the adage attributed to Benjamin Franklin. Those who embrace security to achieve peace achieve neither peace nor security.
Jefferson once said, two things that I particularly remember. From time to time, the tree of liberty must be watered with the blood of patriots and tyrants alike. Jefferson also said, a patriot is one who can take the side of the people against the government, but never the other way around. So I think everyone in the audience has to make decisions now, because we're entering a critical time. Whose side are you on? Are you on anybody's side, or are you just for yourself? Future of your country depends on how you answer and the actions you take to respond to that challenge.
The irony now with Standing Rock, I keep coming back to Ben Franklin bringing two Native Americans to the Constitutional Convention to teach us how to develop a Constitution. I've been listening mostly. I hope all of you have.
And with that, we have the sign. I think our show is over. I'd like to thank Andy for driving all the way up from Shaftesbury.
Yeah, thank
to
Bill
be
for
here
guiding us through this.
And to benefit us with his study, his personal experience, and with his ongoing commitment to the goals of this organization, Veterans for Peace. If you have a friend that's a veteran or you are a veteran, check us out. We're online, we're on Facebook, we're everywhere.
February 18th, Kellogg Hubbard Library, Montpelier, 10 a.m. We'll see you.
That's it. Mm-hmm.